and welcome to another session of Rock School. Last time, you may remember, we were left reeling at the wonders of digital technology. Well, the microchip has brought us a whole lot more than just a few fancy keyboard synths.
What we were playing just now involves using a sequencer and a drum machine. But the important thing is that these pieces of equipment were connected by a control feature known as MIDI. Now, to most players, MIDI looks like this. A lead that you connect two or more pieces of MIDI-compatible equipment and which allows you to make amazing sounds all by yourself. But there's more to MIDI than just that.
Now, MIDI stands for Musical Instrument Digital Interface. It was originally designed in 1983 as a communication link between synthesizers of different makes. Now, if you take this special lead, connecting from the MIDI out to the MIDI in on another synth, you're able to play both at the same time. Now, if you connect to the MIDI through, you're able to, theoretically, chain together as many synths as you like.
Almost every electronic keyboard available today comes equipped with MIDI, and this means you really don't need programming skills in order to get your own unique sound. You can combine sounds from different synths in any way you like. For instance, I can start with this piano sound. And a sustained sound from the Moog. Some bells from the JX10. And within a few seconds, you've got a great sound. The possibilities of MIDI are almost endless. But choose carefully when it comes to putting sounds together, as Jan Hammer explains.
If you actually play something in real time, you can strap as many sounds as you want onto that keyboard, which is wonderful. You have to be careful because things can get totally muddy and lost. But on the other hand, I think sky's the limit. It's wonderful if you can pick the right sounds to layer on top of each other. If some of them have spikes, some of them have pillows, some of them have sheets, some of them have rays, and they all work together, just go, by all means, go ahead and put four synthesizers, five synthesizers on top of each other and create an unheard of sound. But you really have to exercise judgment.
Now, what if you want access to all these new sounds and textures, but you're a guitarist? Well, you can now use the guitar as a synth controller. And here's one of the better known guitar synths that are currently available. It is actually an electric guitar, but it's been fitted with this special pickup. Now, this is linked to this top unit, and this converts the guitar sound into a MIDI signal. This is then MIDI'd into the synthesizer module beneath. Now, a synthesizer module is like a synthesizer, all the sounds and the circuitry, but without the keyboard. So, with this particular guitar synth, you've still got your guitar sound. And I can also add in a synthesizer sound as well. So in this next number, you'll hear just the sound of the synthesizer that's been MIDI'd up, plus I'm playing it from this guitar.
MIDI can also put you in touch with note storage devices known as sequencers. Sequencers are a bit like tape recorders in that they'll record anything you play on your synth, but with two vital differences. They don't use tape and they don't record sound. They record information. When the sequencer plays back, it instructs the synth to make a noise. The machine plays the synth.
Sequencers have in fact been around for quite a long time. Roland and Oberheim were making them in the early 70s. Like everything else in those days, they were voltage controlled analog machines. Their function then, as now, was to trigger predetermined patterns of notes or sequences from the synthesizers that they were plugged into. Now, sequencers have played a great part in the development of synth-pop bands like, for instance, Depeche Mode. It's just a question of time. Situation, I'd say two things are paramount. Firstly, get a good headphone mix because you have to lock in with a click. And having got that, try to groove with a click, treat it as a friend. The first thing to do, I would say, is program a straight fourth to the bar and then maybe add a bit of syncopated percussion so that you've got something to play off so it's not so cold. Maybe something like this one. With the click is now the rule rather than the exception, and the best players are taking the concept of grooving with the click to amazing heights. This is Weather Report and Sting drummer Omar Hakim.
You could play dead on the click, or you can lean behind or before the click, and a lot of times I do that to incorporate a natural feel into things so that it doesn't sound like a click. But in other words, I always work within the time frame that's set by the click, but I can make the click feel very natural, you know? So like when I'm doing fills, I might maybe lay behind the click a little to add tension to it, you know, like. More natural feel. It doesn't sound like the drummer's playing with the click. You can kind of play around with it some.
So drummers are now establishing a two-way thing with the machines, and they're very often inspired by the fresh angles that the machines have brought to rhythms. Just look at the way that Omar adds fresh life to a basic funk groove.
A lot of times now on the records that I've been doing, they've been asking me for very solid patterns between the kick and the snare. Like, for instance, something like, Now, normally you play. Right? These days, now we're doing. The hi-hat dances more. It makes the straight rhythms that you hear between the kick and the snare a lot more interesting, but it doesn't take up so much space in the frequency spectrum of a record.
As with drummers and drum machines, bass players are having to rethink the parts they play due to the arrival of sequencers and MIDI. So whether you're going to play live or in the studio, here are a few ideas on how you can incorporate a sequencer into your band. Do you remember in the first series when I took a funk bass line and broke it down into its component parts? We had clear notes, mutes, pulls, and harmonics. Well, you can take each one of these dynamics, treat them as a separate synth sound, load them into your sequencer, and then play along. Take this continuous pattern, for example. One synth might play the root notes, like this. Then you could play the accents in between with an aggressive synth sound. Now we could get really creative and have a bell sound for the harmonics. In between all those phrases, some percussion. And a percussive synth sound for those phrases. Now the whole thing.
Synth sequences and drum machines can give you access to new sounds and can be a lot of fun. But of course, all this technology can also be very complicated. So we went out and asked two top keyboard players how they managed to cope with the barrage of technology facing the musician nowadays.
A player like me doesn't really have to spend that much time trying to come up with sounds, because there are banks and banks and banks of sounds coming down the MIDI pipeline. And all you have to do is audition all of them. It'll take a while. And then you pick some and you can always edit and make them fit what you want to do. But I've spent, since the advent of MIDI, I've spent less and less time really trying to come up with brand new sounds. Because there are only few sounds that you really like and that you have to make for yourself. And I still do those, homemade. But on the other hand, there are so many sounds that are available. Especially for, let's say, for like the instrument like the Yamaha or the Expander, Oberheim, that there's no reason for anyone to even spend any time and try and tweak the sound from scratch yourself. You know, you just go through the things that are available and you find something that's close, and then you have to know what to tweak to make it perfect for you.
With early synthesizer work, you always program your own sounds. Now, because there's so many instruments and so many different technologies that many musicians are employing the use of other people to do the programming so that they can spend their time and spend their mind conceiving. It's hard to do both because it takes a long time to program. By the time you program this thing, you forget what you were gonna program it for or forget the idea that you're gonna have afterwards. So usually when I'm working on a record, although I do know basically how to program a DX7. When I'm working on a record, I usually have somebody here programming it for me.
So that's their secret. They either use presets and just alter them a little bit to get the sounds they want, or they're lucky enough to have somebody else to do the programming for them. But for the rest of us, it's back to the manuals.